Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to all this morning, and a special welcome to all the mothers in attendance, and then also a special welcome to anybody who's had a mother. So I always say, you know, you wonder sometimes on certain special occasions who it fits and who it doesn't, but the good news is everybody that's sitting in here this morning had a mother, has a mother, so welcome. It's nice to, just talking to Dale for a moment, you know, that spring is always, some weeks we're here it's snowing, some weeks we're here it's, but this is kind of appropriate on Mother's Day, I think, to have a beautiful, sunshiny morning. The first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to hand around, we are having a Mother's Day banquet this coming Saturday night at 6 o'clock. So there's a sign-up sheet that we put out there last week, so just in case you may be one of those ones that said, oh yeah, I'll sign up, and then when you get home, you say, oh, I forgot to sign up, okay? I'm going to pass this around right now, and please feel free to sign up. If you have a friend, a guest, a mother, a daughter, a neighbor, okay, that you'd like to invite, use this as an opportunity even to invite somebody like that out. So this will be Saturday night this coming at 6 o'clock. You know, on Mother's Day, if you happen to... We joked this morning already. Guess one of the songs we're singing? My Mother's Old Bible is true. There's not a lot of songs for Mother's Day or Father's Day that are just specific to that event. But if you ever go on Google and try to find a saying or a Mother's Day poem or whatever else, you can read them till next week. Because I did this the last couple of days, and there's just list after list, which are all good. But I picked out a couple that I thought I'd like to read this morning just to be highlight again Mother's Day. This one is entitled, Her Hands. Her hands held me gently from the day I took my first breath. Her hands helped to guide me as I took my first step. Her hands held me close when the tears would start to fall. Her hands were quick to show me that she would take care of it all. Her hands were there to brush my hair or straighten a wayward bow. Her hands were often there to comfort the hurts that didn't always show. Her hands helped hold the stars in place and encouraged me to reach. Her hands would clap and cheer and praise when I captured them at length. Her hands would also push me, though not down or in harm's way. Her hands would punctuate the words, just do what I say. Her hands sometimes had a discipline to help bend this young knee, just bend this young tree. Her hands would shape and mold me into all she knew I could be. Her hands are now twisting with age and years of work. Her hands now need my gentle touch to rub away the hurt. Her hands are more beautiful than anything can be. Her hands are the reason I am me. That was written by Maggie Pittman. And then this one here was written by a gentleman by the name of Brian Bender. I tried to write so many times, but it's hard to say in rhymes. I'll try once more and hope you'll see just what your love has meant to me. Thank you for your pain at birth that brought me to my life on earth. Thanks for all the time you spent for cuddles and your nourishment. Thank you for the stories read as I lay cozy in my bed. Thanks for your enlightenment to solve new mysteries life has sent. Thank you for the cures and care when sickness caught me unaware. Thanks for tucking me in tight and kisses on my head goodnight. Thanks for comfort when I cried and tissues used for years, tears you dried. Thanks for courage to go on, to see from night a day will dawn. Thanks for freedom that you gave, to go outside the world to brave. Thank you for the friends I meet, that help with friendships I'd repeat. Thank you for your help with school, and teaching me the golden rule. Thank you for praise when I prevailed, and understanding when I failed. Thanks for the parties that you gave and birthday cards I tried to save. Thanks for meals I love so much and baking skills that few could touch. Thank you for your help to write my stories you helped bring to light. Thanks for helping talent service, surface that made me see my life had purpose. Thanks for tears when I left home so I could make it on my own. Thanks for tears when I returned, for visits that you long had yearned. But now, your life I loved has run its course, for time will take us all by force. Your love for me not kept inside, and no conditions were applied. So thanks for all things, small and large, your love saw fit to do no charge. That's our opening prayer this morning. Heavenly Father, we thank you today for this day. We thank you for our loving mothers. We thank you for the blessings that you provided through them for all our lives. Help us today to worship you in this beautiful Sunday. Help us to honor our mothers today and every day. And bless us as we proceed in this service today. Let me pray. Amen.
Thank you for that. Precious memories.
Yeah.
I don't know about you, but that song I really like that song. It's one of those songs, I've mentioned it before, there are certain songs I really like, but for some reason I don't know the lyrics to it real well. So I could be singing part of that song, but then halfway through it, there's a lot of la, 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 la going into it, or adding my own words. So, yeah, thank you for that. That was really pretty. Happy Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day to all you to moms here. Needless to say, you can see that moms are important to the family structure, and to my family. Randy gave me a poem to read. And it's going to be a struggle bus to read it, but I'm going to do it just because I can. And but before I did that, I was thinking this week, and I won't take too long. I don't want to take too much of your time, but I was thinking this week, besides just wishing you Happy Mother's Day, it just seems to me a lot of things that moms do kind of go unnoticed, a lot of behind-the-scenes jobs that kind of are unseen, underappreciated. I don't know, there's not a whole lot of glamour in a lot of the jobs that moms have to do. And I was looking at this, it's been several months ago, I don't even know what I was doing, if I was on Facebook or what, but there's one illustration, and I can't remember what it was exactly used for, but I got thinking about this this week. It was a picture of somebody had done some cross-stitch work. Now, I don't know a whole lot about cross-stitch, but in this particular picture, it was like they showed the front of the cross-stitch, the final product, right? And it was perfect. All the thread was going perfectly, and it was exactly where it should go, and it was depicted the exact picture that they set out to do whenever they started their cross-stitch work. But then it showed the flip side. Now, the flip side was chaotic. It was a mess. There was thread going everywhere. Now, a little truth knowledge here. I have no idea about cross-stitch. Maybe somebody who knows what they're doing with cross-stitch, the back of it looks good too. I don't know. But this particular one, it was chaotic. It was chaotic. There was threads going right, threads going left, doubling back, knotted. I mean, they were going all over the place. And the thought hit me this week, when you think about a mom and everything she does, I remember one time, it's been several years ago, Kent had given an illustration, and I'm assuming it was a Mother's Day service, of all the different things a mom does and basically all the occupations she covers. You know, it's a cook, a therapist, a psychiatrist, a taxi driver. I mean, the list is endless. It just goes on. And basically, if you wanted to pay your mom for everything she did, like actually pay her, you couldn't afford her. Let's be honest. So I got to thinking this week, you know, and I don't want to leave anything out, but I didn't want to be so general and say thank you for all you do, because it just doesn't, it feels kind of hollow to me, even though I know when people say thank you for what you do, they mean it. I just think that when I looked at that cross stitch and I got thinking, you know, just kind of visualize this cross-stitch piece. Maybe it has a picture of a house, has a little fence on it, some flowers, maybe some shrubs. Everything's perfect. A little bit of a sun in the corner of the cross-stitch. Everything's beautiful. But when you flip it, all the threads are going everywhere, left and right. And I think that's kind of where moms come in to play, in my mind. Moms manage the chaos that's on the back of that cross stitch. Moms manage all the things that pop up the last second, and they make a decision on what to do and how things need to be handled. And moms can take care of things that dads can't really handle as well, to be totally honest. I know in my particular family, it's such a comfort to me when I hear my daughter Mackenzie talking to Tony about difficulties she might be having at work or difficulties that she might be having here or there. It means a lot to me to know that my daughter can go to Tony and talk to her about those things. But that's kind of one I wanted to share this morning. I probably didn't do it the most eloquent way that I could have, but in order to get that beautiful cross stitch on the front, it takes a lot of mom's work on the back to make sure all the pieces are put together right. And all the threads are going in the right place. And I'm so thankful for moms. I'm so thankful for my mom and how she raised me. I'm so thankful for Tony and what she does for our family. Honestly, like, they're both real similar in this standpoint. If we're going to have we wouldn't have family functions if it wasn't for Tony. We wouldn't have all our kids together at the same time. There's no way. She handles all of that. Same with mom on that side of the family. We wouldn't have the family functions we have if it wasn't for mom coordinating all that. So thank you for that, and I'm sure anybody else who had an opportunity to stand up here would echo the same thing. So thank you for everything you do, moms. You're greatly appreciated, and it's truly a God's blessing to our families, family units. This is one of the poems Randy gave to me. I'm going to see what I can do here. It's called Guiding Light, Mom, by Carl and Jonah Fuchs. Mom, from the time I was really young, I realized I had someone, you, who always cared, who always protected me, who was always there for me no matter what, who taught me right from wrong and pushed me to do the right thing even when it was hard to do. You took care of me when I was sick, and your love helped me make me well. You had rules, and I learned that when I obeyed them, my life was simpler, better, richer. You were and are the guiding light of my life. My heart is filled with love for you, my teacher, my friend, my mom. So let's start this morning service off. If I can see the call to worship, it's kind of struggling. With the call to worship, it comes from 1 Peter 3:4. It says, "You should be known for the beauty that comes from within, the unfading beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is so precious to God." Amen. So if you turn with me now in your blue hymnals, over to page 419, the Family of God. You should have the words on the screen as well. Let's sing this through 2 times.
Tells of a Savior who suffered for me.
just thought, it's not in the program because I just thought of it. If there's anybody here, I'm going to take a minute here, and if someone else in the congregation wants to stand and say anything or a tribute to their mother may not be here today, you may not want to. But I just figured, you know, Todd and I got the opportunity to be up here and say something. So if you are somebody that wants to give a tribute or something to your mother, I'm going to just give you a couple minutes so somebody can stand and do that. And if you don't, that's okay too. Where's the ushers to come? And today we have a little special treat here for the offertory today that Audrey and Presley are actually, Susie gets the biggest treat out of this, but the rest of us get to benefit also. So they're going to do the offertory for us. So Heavenly Father, we thank you again today for this time to be in your house. We thank you again for being able to come here and worship you, but also take a small moment and a small portion to give back to you gifts that you have blessed us with. So bless this offering as we take it into the use of it into thy kingdom. In your name we pray. Amen.
Presley and RJ. I think that guy's getting a little more used to that piano too, huh? You keep working on it, that's great. That's very good. As we look to the Lord this morning in prayer, we do want to remember our mothers especially. That's been mentioned, and we certainly want to echo what has already been said. While I was sitting back there and listening to you talking about your mothers, I hope this doesn't sound too negative, but I was thinking about all those women down in front of the Supreme Court that are screaming and hollering because they were supposed to be mothers and they wanted to have the choice. And we need to pray for those people. We do. We really do. Because only God can intervene. It just seems like there's a spirit of the enemy that has come in and taken over the minds and the hearts of so many people. And they jumped on the bandwagon, and it was easy to jump on with other people. But we need to pray and ask God to help us and other churches. Millions of people. Every morning when Sonia and I have our devotions and we pray for our nation. And I'm so thankful for the senators and congressmen that I have heard that have testified for Christ and has said that they're reading the word and they're calling upon God. And I hear guys running for office and ladies that are talking about being born again. And that encourages my heart, and I know that prayer, God answers prayer. And so the church needs to keep praying and praying for those circumstances because we certainly can't do anything about it physically, but we have to make it spiritually. And so let's remember that as we pray, plus also the children of the moms. I feel so sorry for children that are raised by those kind of mothers that we're hearing or seeing on the news, and pray that God will intervene and undertake. Today we make a special emphasis about moms. As we lift our hearts in prayer, I'm going to ask you to stand with me if you would please as we pray this morning. Father in heaven, we thank you for the wonderful privilege we have of coming to you in prayer. We thank you, dear Lord, because you are here. We sense your presence, Lord. We thank you, O God, that when we come together and meet in your name, that you promised us that you would help us, Lord. And we just ask that you would do that now. As we pray together, as our hearts are joined together, as we believe in that one God and one Savior, our Lord Jesus Christ, the blessed Holy Spirit of God that comes to us and guides us and helps us and strengthens us in our daily lives and also as we come to worship. We thank you, Father, that you have given us songs that we've been singing this morning. Somebody was touched in their hearts and wrote those songs. Somebody was led to write down the songs, the words that came to their heart and the tune that we can stand and be in the services in the church and sing and pray and sense the Spirit of the living God coming down upon us. And we thank you for that, Lord, from the depths of our heart. We praise you and worship you today in your sanctuary. We thank you for our church. We thank you for our people. Oh, we thank you, Lord, for all that you've given to us. And we thank you for everyone that is involved in serving you today. We thank you, dear Lord, for not only the moms, but we thank you for the children. We thank you, Lord, for the children that have come from these moms and these testimonies that we have heard. We pray that you would bless them and keep blessing them and keep using them and help them to keep looking for places where they can be used, where God can touch their hearts and put them in places where they can help people and where a word here and there can make a difference in someone's life. We pray these things in Jesus' name. We pray, Father, that if there are people here in the service this morning that have special needs on their heart, they've been praying about something, they've been thinking about something, they've been battling something, or they are rejoicing and praising you. We pray that you just help them now, Lord, to praise you better or help them to lift that load that they might be carrying. We pray this morning for our brother Dale as he ministers to us and Sonia. We pray, Lord, as she sings and as he preaches, we pray, Father, that you would bless it and use it in your kingdom. We pray, Father, that you'd give him a clearness of mind, an openness of his heart, and the ability to say and do what you've got for him to say today. We're looking for the truth, Lord. We love the truth, and we just long to hear from you. We pray now, Lord, that you would bless the missionaries today that are in far corners of the world, many of them, most of them that we've never met, that we've never heard of them or even seen or heard anything about them. But you did, Lord. You called them at some camp meeting or some youth camp or some revival or some church service. You called them and they answered you, and they're there today because you called them. And we pray your blessing upon them. We pray that you would touch them, Lord, and help them. There's no doubt missionaries that are crying out to you today to meet needs for them and to help them reach the lost. And we pray in Jesus' name that you would help them. We pray that you would bless our congregation today as only you can. Help us to exalt you this day as we honor our moms. In Jesus' name we pray. And let us repeat the Lord's Prayer together, would you please? Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you, and you may be seated. Sonia is going to bring a song to us at this time. After that, Brother Dale is going to bring us a message. We appreciate his messages and appreciate her singing and their coming to us. And this will be their last Sunday for coming here that we know of. But remember, check your bulletin. The next 3 weeks, Brother Jonas and his family is going to be here. So make sure that you come and be in your place. Thank you very much.
Elisha stood by the
Pennsylvania. Yes. Mark it on your calendar. We don't have too many of them. I was thinking of one of the ladies coming into service tonight. She goes, "I suppose you're going to speak on Mother's Day, right?" Well, I'd like to say a couple things that we all probably know and take for granted. And you know, when God created Adam, he said it was good. He created him a man. Yes? We poo-poo men today. The men are the butt of all jokes, and they're clowns, and they're all this kind of stuff. But God made a man, said it was good. So I think that's a good thing, since I'm a man. But you know the joke, right? God thought, you know what, I can do better. So it's interesting to me how different men and women are, really. You know, in our society, we're wanting to blend that somehow, and it doesn't seem to fit very well. But God made men simple-minded. I hear it all the time in my office. Married, a couple will come in for counseling, you know, go, the wife, usually a frustrated wife, pastor, men, throws me in the same category, apparently. Men, you give them food and intimacy and they're happy. I watch men, they go, like, well, yeah, what else is there? And then the frustrated man will turn to his wife and say, yeah, and you're complicated. It's okay to laugh at that because that's true. Most women will go, I know. And then I get one of two answers. Yes, and you don't get it. That's probably true too, right, ladies? Or the other answer is, yes, and you love it. That's why I'm bald-headed. Okay, I don't understand that, but all right. Listen, it's okay to laugh at our differences, don't you think? I mean, it's what keeps life interesting. And the thing about it is, for most of us men at least, God looked at Adam and said he had no suitable partner. So he took something from his side, we sometimes say it's a rib, and he caused a slumber on Adam. Now, I don't know if God did this, but in our world, maybe I can say, maybe God goes, what does Adam need? So he starts putting together Eve. By the way, Eve's the only person in the creation story created from somebody else. And then from her comes everybody else. I don't know if it happened like this, but maybe God whistles while he works. And he looked over at Adam while he's slumbering and thinking, he's not like this. He's really not like this. And he puts together a woman. Let's call her Eve. You guys are staring at me like I'm making this up or something. I mean, I think I can support most of what I'm saying through the scriptures, just for the record, okay? And when he's done with Eve, it's almost like if you read through that story again, it's almost like he says to Adam, here Adam, you like her? God made Eve to be appealing to Adam. I wonder, I wasn't there, I just know men. I just wonder when Adam saw Eve for the first time, we'll say God's over here, Eve's over here, and God goes, here Adam, here's Eve. I wonder what Adam did. I went, whoa. He's talking to God because he can't take your eyes off of her. Wow, who is this, Lord? Your wife. Wow. I don't know if there's other conversation going on, but I can tell you this. It was the most beautiful thing that ever happened to a man was to have a wife. And God created a woman. You think about, okay, so what is a woman? You ever think about that? What is a woman exactly? First of all, she's not a mistake, man. She's not a mistake, man, you know. So God created a woman to be a woman And she was created to be appealing to Adam. And she is soft. We're more masculine. Rugged made us stronger and gave to us certain commands like the responsibility to show leadership and to be a warrior and be a fixer. Wives enjoy being fixed by their husbands. Have you noticed that? Our tendencies want to be fixers and providers and things like that, you know. And we usually say, we usually grunt. Me Tarzan. Something like that. And then God gives Eve to us. And she goes, what are you talking about this Tarzan stuff? Calm down. Just relax. And then it's a softer version. God created her too. So apparently God understands masculine and feminine. By the way, Christ takes on a feminine role in the scriptures. You remember when he was lamenting over Jerusalem? Jerusalem, Jerusalem. Oh, how I long to hold you as a mother hen would hold her chicks under his wings, her wings. But you would not have it. He took on the role, a feminine role at that point. Yes? So God is both masculine and feminine. You have to think that way. He created us both. But he created Eve to be soft and feminine. Men look at women and say, you're beautiful. I love everything about you. I love your hands. I love your feet. I love that. You know what a woman says? Oh, I got a big nose. What? I don't see a big nose. I see a beautiful woman. It's just our differences. Sammy Kershaw sang a song, says, she don't know she's beautiful. Ever hear that song? She walks into a room and everybody stares. And she goes, what are they staring at? And then he goes on to say, she don't know she's beautiful. God created women to be beautiful. So I want you to know, ladies, you're beautiful today. And one of the components of a woman is that she's able to conceive and bear children. That is uniquely female. No matter what kind of operations we're trying to do today, that's one thing that cannot be duplicated. Because that's designed for the woman and for the mother. Amen. You are specially made to be a woman and a mother. Celebrate it. And don't let this world rob you of it.
Right.
Yes?
Amen.
Brother Kenton referred to the ladies down in front of the Supreme Court. You know and I know, Brother Kenton, you know this. We have an adversary we just love to seek and to destroy, right? Takes what was meant to be beautiful and to tear it down. He does it with all of us in our own ways. I suppose he can't hurt a woman any more than the herder as it deals with her forbearing children. I've had people in my pastoring, I've had ladies come up to me and go, Pastor, I hate Mother's Day. It reminds me of how bad of a mother I really was. I do enough counseling and I've pastored long enough to know that our adversary would just love to shame us for everything we've done wrong and just remind us, just, if only I would have. But that's true for all of us, though, folks. Satan has chased after us, and we have been born and raised and inherited depravity. We know how to sin. Yes?
Yes.
We know how to sin. What we don't know is how to be righteous. And that's why the Lord came, is to teach us what is righteousness, showed us his example, and gave us a book of instruction, and through his Holy Spirit, we grow forward into the Lord. And that's what we're doing here today, is to honor and to worship our Savior and our Creator. Is there any among us here without sin? No. So I want to say to all of us here that no matter what sins you've committed, if you've asked God to forgive you of your sins, the Bible says he has forgiven you.
Amen.
Some of you, I don't want you to turn your head. I don't want you to look at anybody. I don't want you to grunt. Just look at me and don't do nothing. If you had an abortion, God forgives. Sometimes this abortion debate that we have, the women involved are not the problem. They're the victims of some other diabolical emphasis that comes from the adversary to affect God's creation. And we've all been touched in it. We've all done things we look back and say, I wish I've never done. Lord, forgive me of my sins. You know what the Lord says? Okay. Forgiveness is already granted, folks. That's why he died. The tomb is empty. He's already forgiven us. The only way that we exercise forgiveness is through confession. That's it. Lord, I've sinned. Forgive me my sins. You know what he said? If we confess our sins. You know the verse, right? He's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And the scripture says, old things pass away, and behold, all things become new. Listen, I've taught in university before, and I've had a lot of Catholic students. And the Catholics teach at least two different types of sins. There's venial sins and mortal sins. Venial sins are sins, and they're bad, but they're not sins that will send you to hell. White lies, this and that, and so forth. Mortal sins are sins that will send you to hell, like adultery and pride and murder and things like that. And you know, we as evangelicals, we say, well, that's not true. Sin is sin, because it's part of the heart. You steal $10 or $10,000, it's still a sin. The consequences may be a little different. It's still a sin. But we as evangelical believers, we act like Catholics sometimes. You know what we say? Well, I know that I tell lies, but at least I didn't commit adultery. Well, I know that I committed adultery, but at least I didn't have an abortion. We pick and choose these things if we're not careful. And it shames people. We're all sinners. Aside from the grace of God, we're all doomed. I don't care what your sin is, and I want you as ladies to know, no matter what the devil would like to accuse you of this morning, under the blood of Christ, you're free and forgiven.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
We are sitting here as believers. If you have accepted Christ as your Savior, we're sitting here as believers rejoicing in the fact that my sins have been forgiven, and he's invited me to be part of the family of God.
Yes.
We're one of his, he says. So let's rejoice in that today. So ladies, I want you to enjoy Mother's Day this morning. Will you do that? My dad was one of 14 kids. I probably said that to you before. My mother was one of nine. There was a time in my life when I had 56 first cousins. I know. I have cousins that are like, oh. And they're all blue-collar people. They're truckers and railroaders and farmers and factory workers on both sides. I don't know how this happened, but I'm the only pastor in the crew. So, I'm special. Some of you might say, yeah, but you probably ought to be a truck driver because you're not. But my dad was, he always played music and he was gregarious and he was a great father. He taught me to love Jesus. I'm a believer today because I've seen the example of my father. He was a Marine and he was a tender warrior. And I have a lot of good memories of my dad. Me and my two other brothers tried to tackle him one time, say, I think we're ready to take you on, Dad. That was a mistake. My mother was more refined. She was a gentle mother. And she was the one that always wanted me to try to better myself. If it was up to my dad, I'd probably be driving a truck, you know, and then, you know, I don't know, whatever some truckers are like. I'd probably just like them. My mother says, Dale, watch your manners. And Dale, be careful now. And Dale, you need to graduate. Apparently I was teeter-tottering on whether I should graduate or not. And Sonia will tell you this. I never did march in my high school. I never marched. My mother cried. I didn't like school. In fact, I more or less despised school. And I only made it through high school because I think I was one of those students where you have this class of students, and then you have this, and then you have like the promising students that got a college prep students that's going to study for the pastorate and be somebody. I'm down here trying to be a truck driver, and I could care less about school, and they just kind of pushed me through. You know, my English class was called Action Sports. That tells you anything. We touched on grammar once or twice, but that was about it. I remember watching films of the Ali Fraser boxing fight and stuff like that. I said, oh, that's helping me with my grammar. I look back on it now and I'm thinking, holy smokes. It's amazing I'm even standing right now. Anyway, I never marched. My mother, I said, Mom, I don't care. I told you this before, I got paddled 3 times my senior year. And I'm kind of proud of it now. At the time, it wasn't a lot of fun, but it's kind of proud. It's a proud. It's like a scar from war, you know. So see that? After I got saved 2 years outside of high school, and after that, I went back to some of my teachers and asked them to forgive me. I told them I received Christ, and I'm sorry for acting like I did. Just so you know. So after I did get saved, I went off to Bible college. And I kept hearing in my ears, Dale, you need to get an education. Dale, you need to get an education, Dale. My mother refined me. If I have refinement, it comes from my mother. And I never forgot it. And when there was times in college I wanted to quit, I kept hearing in my ear, Dale, you need to get an education. And I determined then, I am going to graduate no matter what. And my mother was able to watch me graduate. So marched down there with that old mortar board. Like, marched, I go, hey Mom, how you doing? You know, wanted her to see me. And she was always that way. So one day, I want to tell you this quick story. I was probably about 12 years old. I grew up in Youngstown, hanging out with my buddies. And we went down the woods, down my end of my road, and there's the woods. 680 goes through it now, but anyway. We used to go sled riding down there, and then we built forts down there. So we built a fort down there. It was about a 4x4 fort. Had carpet on the inside, and we'd go down there and hang out, you know. So we'd go down there, and someone thought it was cool to smoke cool cigarettes, right? So we're in there, two or three of us, knees to knees. That's how small this was. And we're going, let's smoke, you know, so we're smoking. We had so much smoke in that fort, I couldn't even see the guy in front of me. It was rough. Coughing and trying to act cool, you know. And I go, oh, I need to go home for supper. My parents did not smoke. Oh, time to go home for supper. So I got out of the fort, walked up through it, and went up to the neighborhood and went home for supper. My mother had supper on the table. It was just me at the table. I mean, my mother pulls her chair up. Sideways, talks to me, gentle voice. Dale, have you been smoking? I probably smelled like a smokestack. She goes, Dale, you've been smoking? I go, no. Just kept eating. She goes, you know, Dale. And she gave me this little gentle lecture that went right to my heart. She was like a surgeon, I think. The next thing, I stopped eating, and then I started playing with my food. Then I start crying. And when she was done with me, I was bawling like a baby and, man, slobbering, and because my mother gave me a gentle lecture. As you can see, I still remember it. The gentleness of my mom. That night, I got sicker than a dog. It was my mother who got up with me, patted my forehead, took care of me. Dale, you okay? And I thought, man, I remember that as a kid. My mother's actually helping me right now for something she just lectured me over. Well, I don't smoke today. There was a phase where I learned how to blow smoke rings. I thought it was cool. Cigarette out of my mouth, shooting pool. It didn't last. I kept hearing my mother's voice. I want to tell you something. God created a woman. And some of you who may want children, could not have children, doesn't diminish your womanhood at all. God created a woman be a woman, because God knew that men needed women, and this world needed women. And if I was a woman, I would walk very tall, because you control almost everything that goes on in this world. God has given to the woman influence. God has given a responsibility to men to lead. God has given to the woman influence. It's just as powerful. In fact, it's so powerful. Probably had to throw this in this conversation, but it's so powerful that Eve convinced Adam to sin. That's how bad that's how strong that influence is. And Adam failed in his leadership, because they've written books over this. The silence of Adam. He never spoke up. I suppose because the influence of a woman is so strong. So ladies, if you ever doubt anything, remember, you are a woman of influence. Use it for God. I want to bless and honor you as ladies and women of this congregation. I want to honor you and bless you as a woman. God bless you all. It's so strong, just for the record, because some of you already know. I lost my wife nearly a year ago. And he allowed me to get introduced to Sonia. Last time we were here, this was not known. Some of you know about it. But I asked Sonia to marry me last Sunday. Just for the record. Well, I had her down with my arm behind her back. Well, listen, if the truth would be known, she's already asked me to marry her about 100 times. But anyway, I'm thankful to the Lord to have the privilege to speak with you today. I feel led, as I was preparing this throughout this past week, I felt led to share what I'm going to share with you. I want to talk with you about something that I have learned in new ways, most particularly in the passing of my wife. But even prior to that, the older I get, I'm 65, the older I get, I remember telling my children, I said, listen, they're going through something. I said, listen, be patient, wait. Wait upon the Lord. Give them time. Yeah, but Dad, I know, just wait. God's doing something. If you're going through a trial or a tribulation, God's doing something. He promised to be with us. We don't want to get impatient. Or we don't want to think we know better than God. You know how easy it is to do that? Well, I think I'm going to help God out, because I'm not sure he really knows what's exactly going on here. So D.L. Moody, I heard this quote the other day. D.L. Moody said this, trust in yourself and you're doomed to disappointment. Trust in your money and you may lose it. Trust in other people and they may betray you or die. Trust God, and in God you will never be confounded in time or eternity. Yes. The problem with us is we are so limited to time and space, and God is not. It is so easy for us not to appreciate what eternity means. I think we understand the concept, but we can explain the concept. I don't think we understand it. There's no way. We don't know what life is like with no time. We know what time is because I'm 65. I just put a time limit on me. Maybe 20 more years. Maybe, Sonia. You might be marrying a guy that's going to, you know, go faster in 20 years. So I told her, I said, you know, one of us is going to bury the other. That's the concept we have, I have. She lost her husband. I lost my wife. We think of time as a birth and death. God doesn't. And so sometimes we get like impatient. Come on, man, it's been like 3 months. How long have you been looking and praying for a pastor? How long?
Since October.
What's that?
Since October.
Okay, like, come on, Lord. We've been looking for a long time. What does God want from you all? What's God's will for you? Some of you might say, I don't know. We don't know. We're still praying. But do we believe that God is with us and God hears our prayers? Do we believe that?
Yes.
So what's the hindrance? It's almost like, I don't know, it's getting a little nerve-wracking. We're praying. I heard this from Dr. David Jeremiah. He quoted this in one of his sermons. I've been listening to him quite a bit. He said this: two natures beat within my breast. The one is foul and one is blessed. One I love and one I hate. The one I feed will dominate. So we have to be careful of this. Like, we can feed our doubts if you want. So, briefly, because I don't want to be too long. I know we've already had a full service. I just want to touch on waiting upon the Lord. And then maybe after I share, maybe we'll have our sister come up on the organ and just quietly play. And maybe I would invite us, those who can make it, or you don't have to, maybe come around the altar and then we'll just calm ourselves. We'll touch on what waiting means. And then maybe we can wait upon the Lord this morning and see what he has for us, where he may want to take us. It's one thing to know God is love. And it's another thing to experience God's love. It's one thing to know we are to love our neighbors, and it's another thing to love them. It's one thing to know God forgives sin. It's another thing to have your sins forgiven. It's one thing to know God has a plan for me, and it's another thing to do God's plan. It's one thing to know God accepts me this moment for who I am. It's another thing to accept his acceptance. It's one thing to know God is in control of the world. It's another thing to be at peace in a world that's going crazy. Do we believe God's in control?
Yes.
Are we willing to surrender ourselves to the way God wants to do things, or the way I think that ought to be done? It's so easy to allow that to skew even how we pray. We sometimes think we know what's right down here in this congregation. We know this congregation. So we have to inform God what this congregation is like. So God, you need to do this. You know what I mean, right?
Oh, yeah.
I know what's going on. Well, I don't know. I know what's going on. Well, then why don't you do something? Because there's a lot you don't know right now, and I'm doing something, so be patient. Wait. What is it to wait upon the Lord? One definition of a commentary said, to wait upon the Lord is the believer's robust activity. It's robust activity to wait. That's not how we think, is it? Like, come on, let's get her done. Okay, wait. So if trusting the Lord, if it's robust activity as we quiet ourselves before the Lord to recognize that waiting is the activity we need to be doing. Because God's doing something. Expectant, here's another definition. Expectant. Waiting is to expect. Expectant. Trust and hope in God's movement in activity. God's moving. Setting aside, here's another definition, setting aside our own abilities, skills, and activities. Setting them aside. It's a dependence on God to act on our behalf. I think 2 Corinthians talks about trading our weaknesses for his strength. Psalm 23 is to rest. To rest. Makes me, the Lord makes me, you know this, don't you? Makes me to lie down in green pastures. Plenty. Next to quiet waters, peace. He restores my soul. I find whenever I, Romans 12:2 says, be not conformed to this world, right? Pushed into the mold of this world. This world is full of anxiety and anger and impatience and selfishness. Be not conformed to this world. You know the verse? But be transformed. How? By the renewing of your mind. Well, we know that verse, right? I've been experiencing more and more, I think as I get older and go through even the more recent trials or tribulations, I can tell the difference. After a day of living and working and doing things, you can be weary, right? You're weary, weary-minded. I'm tired. I don't want to think. I don't want to read. I don't want to do anything. I need to sleep. So you get in bed and you sleep. You wake up the next morning. David talks in the Psalms that his mercies are renewed every morning. And so I need to renew my mind every day because it's just been polluted by the day before. So I wake up and I spend enough time with the Lord to get a fresh touch from God. It doesn't have to be 2 hours every morning, but somewhere you get that touch and your mind is shifted again to the mercies and the power and the grace of the Lord. And you feel like, you know what, I can't hardly wait to get into my office today to do ministry again. When the day before I couldn't wait to get out of my office because I was weary. Have a renewed mind. Be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. We have to renew our minds in the things of the Lord, or else we will be overcome and heavy laden. And then we get grumpy and impatient, and then we start telling people what to do, and all this kind of stuff, because why? Relax. I can't relax. And you know, I've said it before being here, I have friends that's like, you just give them the word, they're going to go out and shoot somebody, or going to punch somebody, because they don't like what's going on in this world, and this, I tell you what, it's a man, we need to stand up. Relax. I got to be careful, I might turn around and get punched. Just relax, dude. You would think I'm the enemy now, because you told me to relax because you're not getting into it like you need to get into it. I said, well, there is such a thing as trusting the Lord, don't you think? To rest. He causes me to rest. Sometimes we may be so anxious and the whole time God's going, hey, slow down. I need to talk to you. Can't even hear him. We're too caught up. In Exodus 14, when the people of God were confronted with the Red Sea, 14:14 says, the Lord will fight for you. All you have to do is to be silent and calm. Trusting him, not the circumstances. Almost like Matthew 6:33 says, it's a quiet wait. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. If we want to look at examples of those who fail to wait, let's look at Abraham and Sarah and Hagar. That's an interesting story. You know the story, right? Hey, Adam, apparently God meant someone from my household. Why don't you take Hagar and lay with her? I can joke about that. As a man, okay, I'll lay with her. Biggest mistake of his life. They were impatient. The benefit of waiting, Isaiah 40:31, right? That he will renew our strength. Those who wait upon the Lord, he will renew our strength. John 14:15, this is the confidence we have toward him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us in whatever you ask, we know we have the request we ask of him. Do not despair when God seems to be taking more time than you wish to act on your behalf. He knows. He knows best. Isaiah 30:18 says, "Therefore the Lord waits to be gracious to you. Therefore he exalts himself to show mercy to you. For the Lord is a God of justice. Blessed are all those who wait for him." We tend to think in terms of microwaves, because we don't have time to turn the oven on. We'll let it warm up for 20 minutes. I heard someone say this the other day. We look at microwaves, God looks at acorns. In Isaiah 61, 1 through 3, he talks about how the Lord has a way of turning out of despair, he brings peace, and his righteousness then becomes a part of who we are. And he says they will grow to be oaks of righteousness. It takes time to grow an oak. If we're thinking like microwave, we're in trouble. As my wife was in hospice, I may have shared this to you a few times ago, but when my wife was in hospice, I was overwhelmed by darkest days, and I knew she was dying, and I was joyful because I saw God's hand in it, and his presence was evident, but I was overwhelmed, and I was in my bedroom where I spent time with the Lord, and I was listening to Dr. David Jeremiah. And it just so happened, maybe by the providence of God, he was doing this series. If you listen to him, you know he's done a series on overcomers and things like that. This one series was, he goes, the title of it, "Why Does God Allow Bad Things Happen to Good People?" That's a question that's pretty familiar. And I was at a time when I go like, whoa, got my pen eyes on that. I'm going to take notes on this one. And he said things that I just shared with you. I've shared this before in many places, Pastor. I know what waiting is. But when I was going through the deepest struggle, I said, I want to hear what he has to say about it. He shared some of the very same things I just shared. Somehow, in my desperation, I heard it differently. Somehow, when we realize our need is so great, sometimes we listen, and maybe God allows us to get to the place where our need is so great that finally we listen. And so he gave this definition of waiting, which is similar to what I just said, but he said it like this. The word carries with it to cease activities. You know, when you're anxious, for me, I start shaking my leg, you know, wrapping my fingers. Probably ought to do the dishes. I probably ought to do this. And in my mind, I'm going through this list of what I got to do today. And okay, I got to spend time with the Lord. Okay, Lord, okay, I'm done with my devotions. Got to go. He said, cease activities. I remember sitting in my chair. I think it was the Holy Spirit. Cease activities, Dale. Slow down. Calm yourself. Rest. I remember thinking, yes, I need to do that. I need to cease activities. I'm just all ramped up. Hit pause on the TV. I went like this. Lord, I need to calm myself down. I'm calming myself down. I need to know that you're here with me. And I rested. I can tell you, folks, with tears in my eyes, had an overwhelming sense of God's peace at a time when I was most desperate. Here's a word image that comes to my mind when I think of that episode. Here's what I thought of it instantly. I felt like I saw something coming down, apparently from heaven, into my room. I didn't see anything. I'm telling you, this is what I felt. Came down like this, and it went like this. And it just filled every nook and cranny of that bedroom. That's what it felt like. I was overwhelmed. peace. I can't explain that. And that's what Philippians talks about. You get a peace that passes understanding. I can't explain that. At the most desperate time of my life, I sensed the presence of God only, not because of me, only because the nudging of the Holy Spirit said, just cease activities and just experience me right now, I guess. I've never forgot that. It taught me fresh and anew. And I've been trying to practice that. I find myself getting all worked up with stuff and getting worried and fretting. And no, you know what's going on, Lord. You saw me in my bedroom.
Amen.
I know. He's ever present. We don't want to forget that in our day of busyness.
That's right.
Oh, it's time to go to church. Hurry up. Hurry up, Pastor. Get done because the sunshine may change in a few hours. Hurry up. Hurry up. Let's go. Let's do this. Let's do that. And like, oh yeah, by the way, let's pray for a pastor. So I want to close today with maybe Sister, if you'd come. And I don't want anyone to feel like they have to come forward. This is not an altar call. But maybe this is a time when the church leadership and those of us that are part of this church can just comfort ourselves by, even for this moment, to calm whatever pressures this world's trying to cram in on us, that we can just say, no, in this moment, I'm going to wait upon the Lord and see what He has to say for me or for us in this group. Maybe God's going to give a word to everyone here, the same word. And if He gives the same word, then we pretty well know what God's trying to say to us. What is God trying to do? Is he wanting you not to have a pastor? Maybe He wants you to have multiple pastors. Maybe He has someone special, but we're not ready to receive it yet because our minds are too caught up with the way we think God ought to be moving.
Amen.
Maybe God has something for us that we're only going to experience unless we wait upon Him enough to hear His voice. God wants to do a work here in Oak Grove. No. Grove City? Sorry about that. God wants to do a work here, doesn't He? How does He want to use us? Let's be open to what God might say. Let's wait upon the Lord today. So if we want to take a moment, and if someone to come around the altar, listen, we don't do this all the time, but you could if you want. It helped me. It helped my mind to know what I was doing. Lord, I cease activities. I need to know that You're here, and I need to know what You want from me or us. Let's just take a moment. We'll close our service that way. Would that be okay with everybody? Why don't we stand, unless you'd rather sit. If you want to sit, that's fine. Those who want to come forward, let's come forward, and then I'll close in prayer after we wait upon the Lord for a little bit. So I'll just leave it up to whoever comes. We'll trust the Lord. Heavenly Father, we're so, so thankful for Your faithfulness to our hearts and our lives.
Yes.
We thank You for Your love, that in spite of our sin, You died for us because You love us, You have plans for us,
yes.
You're intimately involved in all of our lives. Forgive us, Lord, of those times when we rush, go and do things, Lord, that sometimes we regret. As we quiet our hearts this morning, Lord, in this beautiful sanctuary, we're mindful of your presence, Lord. Such a beautiful thing. Such a beautiful thing to be able to have communion with the Creator. When I quiet myself before you, Lord, I realize that you're not hurried. You're not in a rush. You know our needs, Lord. Each one of us have our personal concerns. We ask and I pray for this congregation that you would minister to the needs of every person, young and old, in the way according to your will. I pray for this church as a congregation that you would unite our hearts to be able to discern what your will is for us. Show yourself strong on this behalf, Lord. Open our eyes and our hearts to your will, whatever it is. Maybe you want to do something different in us. We're surrendering ourselves, Lord, this day. Lord, here am I. Do with me as you wish. Here we are, Lord, as a church. Do with us as you wish. Thy will be done. And we have peace in trusting you with that. As your Spirit falls on us today in a new way, fill every nook and cranny of this sanctuary, Lord. Let it be forever a sanctuary. Remind us of your presence, your peace in a world that's crazy. Help us to see and live in the things that are most important. I want to thank you, Lord, for the gift of a woman and the gift of a mother, and for our mothers today and our lady folks. Bless their lives in new ways. Encourage them. Prepare our hearts for what you have for us. And I now pray these things through Jesus Christ, our Lord. And everybody said amen.
Amen.
Amen. God bless you. As far as I'm concerned, the service is over.